Welcome to Introduction to Scheduling. An event planner has to manage many workers completing different tasks, some of which must be completed before others can begin. For example, the banquet tables would need to be arranged in the room before the catering staff could begin setting out silverware. The event planner has to carefully arrange the activities or schedule things so that the project gets done in a reasonable amount of time. And the problem of scheduling is fairly universal. Contractors need to schedule workers and subcontractors to build a house as quickly as possible. A magazine needs to schedule writers, editors, photographers, typesetters, and others so that an issue can be completed on time. Let's consider an auto shop that is converting a car from gas to electric. A number of steps are involved. A time estimate for each task is given. Notice we have a total of 9 tasks, and the approximate time to complete each task is given here on the right. Some tasks have to be completed before others, while their tasks can be completed at the same time. So for example, task 1, removing the engine and gas parts, would need to be done before task 6, installing the motor. However, maybe steps 2 and 3 could be done at the same time. For example, someone could be steam cleaning the inside of the car while someone else is buying the electric motor and speed controller. To help us visualize the ordering of tasks, we create what's called a diagraph. A diagraph is a graphical representation of a set of tasks in which the tasks are represented by dots called vertices, and arrows between vertices are used to show ordering. A complete diagraph for our car conversion might look something like this. Notice how, again, there are 9 tasks, T1 through T9. If we look at task 1 just for a moment, notice how task 2, as well as tasks 6, 7, 8, and 9, cannot be completed until first task 1 is completed. The time it takes to complete this job will partially depend upon how many people are working on the project. In scheduling, the workers completing the tasks are called processors. In our car example, the processors are probably humans. However, the processors can be computers, robots, or other types of machines. The finishing time is how long it takes to complete all tasks. The finishing time will depend upon the number of processors and the specific schedule created. If we only had one processor working on a task, it is easy to determine the finishing time. We would just add up the individual times for each task. For example, if we had one processor working on the task of converting this car from gas to electric, it would be easy to determine the finishing time. We would just add up the individual times. The finishing time would be 10 days, as we see here. Notice how the processor is completing the task in the order here. Task 1, 3, 4, 5, 2, 6, 7, 8, 9, taking 10 days. This is certainly not the only possible schedule for one processor, but no other schedule can complete the job in less time. Because of this, this is an optimal schedule with optimal finishing time. Again, when we only have one processor. So again, an optimal schedule is the schedule with the shortest possible finishing time. For example, if we had 2 processors, the schedule might look something like this. Notice with 2 processors, the finishing time was reduced to 5.5 days. But you might be asking, what did processor 2 do during this last day? Well, notice how they're not completing a task, and therefore the processor is doing nothing, and this is called idle time. Idle time is time in the schedule when there are no tasks available for the processor to work on, so they sit idle. Now that we've seen it would take 10 days for one processor and 5.5 days for 2 processors, let's see what would happen if we had 3 processors. Well, down here at the bottom, here's a possible schedule for 3 processors. Notice for 3 processors, it takes 4.5 days. So as you can see, as we have more and more tasks and more processors, scheduling can get more complicated. And we're also simplifying this process because we are assuming all processors can complete all tasks and all processors can complete all tasks in the same amount of time, which, you know, in reality would not necessarily be the case. So with more and more tasks and more processors, it becomes difficult to determine the optimal schedule. However, in our example, Notice that task 1, 2, 6, and 9 have to be completed sequentially, which we can see here, task 1, 2, 6, and then 9. Looking at the times of each task, notice there's no way to complete this job in less than 2 plus 0.5 plus 0.5 plus 1, or 4 days, regardless of the number of processors. 4 days is, for this diagram, the absolute minimum time to complete the job, which is called the critical time. So to say that again, the critical time is the absolute minimum time to complete the job, regardless of the number of processors working on the task. Critical time can be determined by looking at the longest sequence of tasks in the diagraph, called the critical path. So again, we already pointed out that this path gives a total of 4 days. No other path will be longer than 4 days. So for example, if we took, let's say, this path here, notice how this would be 2 plus 0.5 plus 1, that's 3.5, and since 4 is longer, 4 is your critical time. As another example, we could go from task 3 to task 7 to task 9. Notice this path takes 2 plus 0.5 plus 1, or 3.5 days, so still the longest path is 4 days, our critical time. So we'll now begin to look at algorithms that can be used to help create a priority list and a schedule. The future topics that we'll discuss are listed here. I hope you found this introduction helpful.